KETV News Watch 7 takes an in-depth look at stories impacting our community. Stories making a difference. Stories that matter to you. This is KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle.
I just registered to vote like last week, so it's been really hitting me heavily lately that we got a lot of decisions to make on our plate coming up here. So
sticking to your promise is the future in it. That's really what I see in it. That's what I'm going for, and I'm not just going to go automatically for one candidate. I'm actually going to look into it.
Well, just making sure that it's there, you know, and for myself. And the other thing is, but for the future, for the kids. We've paid in for it all these years, and now all of a sudden, you don't know what to believe.
I definitely feel the same like he does about Social Security.
Because we need more people to have jobs out here. I got one, but it ain't the best, but...
Would you keep Obamacare in place? Because it provides care for the aged, disabled, and other parts of our population that are unable to care for themselves otherwise.
Well, those are just some of the issues important to voters as the election gets closer. Good morning, I'm Rob McCartney. This is another special Commitment 2012 edition of KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle. For the next 2 weeks, we're focusing on Nebraska's 2nd Congressional District. We invited both Republican incumbent Lee Terry and his Democratic challenger John Ewing to spend 30 minutes with us discussing the topics that matter most to you and to them. We recorded both of the interviews in the same week. Neither candidate had a chance to watch or hear the other's response. We actually flipped a coin to see which interview would air first, and that will be John Ewing. Next week, we'll talk with Lee Terry. Both interviews will be online on KETV.com. First, a bit of history. John Ewing's been a lifelong Nebraska public servant. He spent 24 years with the Omaha Police Department. This is video of him 12 years ago as he participated in National Police Week. He rose to the rank of deputy chief. Ewing retired in 2007 after he ran for Douglas County Treasurer and won. Our camera was there as he took the oath of office.
I, John W. Ewing, Jr.
I, John W. Ewing, Jr.
do solemnly swear.
He has served as treasurer for the past 5 years, was reelected in 2010. A year later, Ewing announced his plans to run for Congress.
I'm a proven leader. I've been in leadership positions throughout my professional career, as well as I've worked on 30 different community boards, most of which I ended up being in a leadership position.
Well, John Ewing says he wants to bring more jobs to Nebraska, help get America back on track by providing capital for entrepreneurs. But what issues are most important to voters? Latest survey, taken just a couple weeks ago by the Pew Research Center, shows the economy tops the list. It's followed by jobs, specifically, and health care. Also making the list, education, the budget deficit, taxes, Medicare, and terrorism. Well, as we begin our interview with Mr. Ewing, take a look at these poll numbers. They're from August 23rd from We Ask America. It's a conservative leaning polling firm. Shows a relatively close race between Terry and Ewing. Terry at 46%, Ewing at 40%. Poll's margin of error is 3 points. And joining me this morning to discuss the race and the issues is John Ewing. Thanks very much for joining us this morning.
Thank you, Rob.
All right. What do you think about those poll numbers first? 6 points different, that accurate?
Well, I believe it is. I believe it also shows that we're within the margin of error and moving forward. We were also in that poll winning independent. So I think we've got a great chance to win this race and give Nebraska the type of leadership they deserve in the 2nd Congressional District.
All right. County Treasurer, Deputy Police Chief, are there any qualifications from those jobs that will transfer over onto the national stage? You have to make decisions on foreign policy, for example. Anything from your jobs now that would transfer?
Well, I think the first thing you have to look at is where we're at with our budget debt, $16 trillion. I'm the only one in this race who's balanced a budget. I've balanced budgets with the Omaha Police Department, the Douglas County Treasurer's Office, as well as a number of community boards that I've served on over the years. So I think that is critical experience because you have to be willing to make the tough decisions. You have to be willing to prioritize and make sure that you're cutting where you're not necessarily hurting people. And I've done that for a number of years. I've done that with the police department, the treasurer's office, as well as in the community, as I've said. The other thing people may not know is that I actually was very involved with Homeland Security during my time as a deputy chief, coordinating Homeland Security for both Douglas, Washington, and Sarpy counties as part of an urban area security initiative where we were actually competing nationally for funding to be able to make sure our community was safe. And we did that very well and actually received quite a substantial amount of money to keep these communities safe, from Offutt Air Force Base to the College World Series to the Fort Calhoun nuclear plant. So I'm very proud of that effort. I also have served in a number of capacities with the Douglas County Treasurer's Office, where we've won a national award for our treasurer's business model and the efficiencies we generated, as well as the tax savings that we've been able to provide to the citizens of Douglas County.
All right, we're approaching that so-called fiscal cliff, more than $1 trillion in mandated spending cuts will kick in. They're talking about it. First off, do you think that will happen? And then second, they're talking about making those cuts relatively equal between programs like Medicare and defense. If you had to make a choice between one or the other, which would it be? So first, do you think it's going to happen?
I have no confidence in this Congress. When you look at even what the Associated Press said about this particular Congress, they're the most partisan and the least effective in at least a generation. I have no confidence that they will do the job of the American people. If they were, they would be there now working to get these issues resolved rather than coming back to their districts to campaign and worry about their own job rather than what's best for America. So I believe it will happen.
So you believe the cuts will happen. Okay, then if they happen, if they had to choose between Medicare and defense, I mean, would you sacrifice one over the other?
I believe first you can make some changes in Medicare to soften the blow, where you can actually allow the Health and Human Services Secretary to be able to negotiate drug prices and some of those type of things to actually impact the program but not the people. So I believe you can make some progress there. I also believe that you can make some progress in the defense area by really listening to what the military is saying. If you listen to all of the campaign rhetoric that's going on right now, the Republican Congress is, and the Republican candidate for president, they're actually talking about adding $2 trillion to the defense budget that the Defense Department has said they don't need. That would be like asking the Omaha Police Department to spend money they don't need. That's not good government. So I believe you can make some strategic cuts in both areas without impacting the effectiveness.
What would you cut then in, say, Medicare? We'll begin with Medicare. I mean, that would not affect the people, like you say.
Well, as I pointed out, you can actually have the Health and Human Services Secretary right. be able to negotiate drug prices mm-hmm. just like they do with veterans benefits. And that would actually save you potentially about 50% of the cost in that particular area. You can also cut the 14% profit in Medicare Part C, which would save about $50 billion a year. You can also do more in investigating fraud and waste in Medicare, and for every dollar we invest in investigating fraud, we save the taxpayer $7. So those are the types of things you can do in Medicare today to make that program more efficient and not touch the benefits of those who are in those programs. And that's the kind of thinking and leadership we need in Congress right now.
What about defense? What would you cut there besides the $2 trillion that you say they're not asking for? Is there anything currently in defense that we could cut?
Well, I would get out of Afghanistan yesterday
okay.
as one example. We need to quit being the policemen of the world and start nation building here. I believe then we can take those savings and actually then begin to invest in our own nation. So the first thing I would do is get out of Afghanistan and make some cuts there. I believe we also need to talk to the military leaders, not just us saying, oh, here's what I think we need to cut. I believe it's important, just like I've done in the Douglas County Treasurer's Office, we save the citizens of Douglas County over $1 million a year. I didn't just come in one day and say, here's where we're going to make cuts. I talked to the senior leaders of that organization, others in government, and the citizens of Douglas County to say, what would you like us to do more efficiently? And that was delivering service more efficiently through online service, service over the telephone, as well as through the mail. So I think you have to be willing to listen, go in with your own ideas on where you think you can do it, but then listen to the experts.
All right, a couple other issues I want to get to real quick. You are an associate minister at Salem Baptist.
Yes.
Would you vote to overturn Roe versus Wade?
Here's what I would tell people, because I think people are fundamentally confused on the role of the Constitution.
Okay.
The House of Representatives cannot overturn a United States Supreme Court decision. So to say one way or the other that you would vote to do something when you don't have the power to do it doesn't make sense. I believe what we need to do is work where we can get some things done. And that's common ground. That's the fact that we have 6 million pregnancies in the United States each year, and we have over 3 million unplanned pregnancies. What we need to do is work comprehensively with sex education, with access to birth control for those women who want that, so that we can reduce the number of unintended pregnancies. When we do that, then we also need to make sure that we're supporting women and making it possible for them to be able to make the decision to keep that child. And once that child is born, make sure that that child has the opportunity to live the American dream. I say that to say that is pro-life, which I am, not pro-birth. And I believe that's where we have a chance to have common ground. Saying you're going to vote to overturn something that you can't just isn't honest.
Yeah, but you could vote on a measure, a bill that would eventually lead to that. I mean, the idea of overturning Roe versus Wade.
I would not. Right. I would believe it would be just like voting 33 times to repeal the Affordable Health Care Act. It's symbolic. I don't do things for symbolism. I do things to get things done for the people. And so I believe working to reduce the number of unintended pregnancies is the way we're going to help solve that problem.
All right. Well, we're going to take a short break. Up next, though, John Ewing and his plans to end the gridlock in Washington, D.C. He mentioned that, an issue that's top of mind for voters regardless of which political party they support.
The people in Washington don't do anything. They fight over who they are and what they want. They only work to get reelected, and they end up doing nothing. Pure and simple.
You're watching a special Commitment 2012 edition of KETV Newswatch 7's Chronicle.
What we need in Washington, D.C. are executives who can make decisions, build consensus, and help get things done rather than debating back and forth like you've heard in Congress today. But it's
easy to be. So will it work? Is Ewing the man to end the gridlock in Washington and reach across the aisle to make compromise happen? Welcome back to this special Commitment 2012 edition of KETV Newswatch 7's Chronicle. With me this morning is Democrat John Ewing. So if elected, what will you do to be that consensus builder, especially as a freshman?
Sure. Well, let me go and give you a little bit of history about John Ewing. I work across party lines every day as the Douglas County Treasurer. I have hired on purpose a Republican chief deputy and have had that person there working with me since I started, because I believe it's important to be responsive to the entire community. And we've done a great job for the citizens of Douglas County. I also have worked across party lines when I talked about the Urban Area Security Initiative, working with the governor's office, working with other law enforcement agencies across the state and across the metropolitan area. As the Douglas County Treasurer, I am one of three or four Democratic County Treasurers out of 93. And I was able to help bring that group together to get online services for the entire state of Nebraska within the first 16 months of my time in the Douglas County Treasurer's office. So I believe that I have worked across party lines, even going back to my time as a lieutenant with the Special Victims Unit, when we were able to get a number of laws passed to protect women and children. I was able to work with Attorney General John Bruning and a number of others from across the state to get things done for the people. I believe what's important is to cast a compelling vision for the people, for the future, just like we've been able to do in the treasurer's office, just like I did in the police department, just like I did when I was chairman of the Von Maur Victims Fund, where now that is a national model for United Ways. I've been able to bring people together, have them focus on what the goal is, and then make sure we take advantage of each person's expertise, make sure each person has an opportunity to be part of the solution and get things done for the people, and I'll do that in Washington, D.C.
You know, some people may say, how can you be a consensus builder if you were one of the co-chairs for President Obama's campaign in 08 for the 2nd Congressional District? They'll
sure.
say, how can you actually, you know, stand up to the White House when you actually helped, you know, elect him?
Sure. Well, you have to remember this, Rob. I'm an independent thinker. I've worked across party lines, like I said, and I will work across party lines and say no to the president when he's wrong. My goal is to serve the people of this district, as I have for over 30 years now. My commitment is not to a party. My commitment is not to the president. My commitment is to the people of America and to the people of this district. And that's the only pledge I'm going to take. I'm not taking a pledge from Grover Norquist or anybody else. I strongly believe in protecting Social Security and Medicare. And when I was given a questionnaire that seemed like a pledge because they were asking me to say, I will never, and all of those type of things, I would not fill out that questionnaire. And so that is who John Ewing is, an independent thinker who will work to build consensus across party lines and across all of the other artificial barriers that divide us.
Okay, talking about party lines then, the Patient Protection Affordable Care Act.
Yes.
That was obviously very contentious of political lines. Some say repeal it completely, get rid of the whole thing. I mean, Governor Romney has said that when he gets in office, that'd be basically job one, one of them, to get as many Republicans have. Are there parts of it that you would change that would be palatable to both sides? And if so, what are they? Or is it fine as it is?
Oh, I don't believe it's fine as it is.
Okay.
So that's the first thing I want to make very clear. I think there's some great things in it when you look at people not having to worry about pre-existing conditions, young people being able to stay on their parents' insurance, closing the donut hole for seniors. Mm-hmm. All of those things are great things. I've heard some concerns by small business owners that they don't have certainty. They don't know what to expect because of this law and because of some of the other things that have been done in Washington, D.C. In order to get 23 million Americans back to work, we've got to fix that aspect of this particular legislation and make sure that businesses understand what the legislation is about. And then secondly, that we make the changes necessary with their input so that we can have a bill that works for America. It can't just be something that is pushed through by one party or fought against by another party. It has to be something where we build consensus and we make it work for the American people and for the companies that employ Americans.
Couple more topics. Energy is a hot topic.
Yes.
I mean, specifically wind energy. Tax credit for wind energy runs out at the end of the year. Would you reinstate those tax credits, or do you think, like some do, that all energy should be on a completely level playing field, competing equally for any kind of tax break, if you will?
I believe that we should continue those tax credits. And here's another step that I think we need to take when we look at Nebraska being the fourth windiest state in the country. We need to sit down with MUD, OPPD, and Nebraska Public Power District as well and figure out how they can be involved in that energy field so that we can take advantage of that and actually create jobs in Nebraska and also then be able to help supply the energy, the country's energy needs, because we have to think not only today, and 5 years from now, but we have to begin to think long term as well. And renewable energy is going to be what we need to do long term to make America energy independent.
Okay. Another issue, foreign policy. If you're asked to vote on a declaration of war, what would be the trigger point for you to say, yes, we should commit America troops to a war?
Sure. I'm a very practical person. So the first thing I have to see is that this somehow threatens the security of America. Secondly, that it's a winnable war. We've gotten into wars that didn't necessarily threaten America's security, such as Iraq. And then we've gotten into wars and stayed in wars with no clear objective, such as Iraq or Afghanistan. And I believe what we need to do is recognize, and I recognized this during my time with the Omaha Police Department when we had difficult situations, that you are risking the lives of our young people. And it's not the same as the military, but it's still making sure that you make good decisions and you take calculated risk rather than risking the lives of our brave men and women in the military for things where we shouldn't be going to war. So I would be very cautious about ever sending our young men and women to war. And just another point, I would make sure that once they came back from those foreign tours, that we took care of them. Right now, we have far too many young people who are committing suicide, who have post-traumatic stress syndrome, and the House voted not to increase funding, and Lee Terry voted not to increase funding to support those young men and women. They also voted not to support reunification of their families and not to support additional funding for education. We can't send them to war and then forget about them when they get back here.
Still to come, a chance for John Ewing to tell you what's most important to him, what he's hearing from voters in the 2nd Congressional District. First, a reminder, your comments are an important part of the show. If you want to be heard, a couple ways you can do it. Call us directly, 402-978-8960. Speak clearly. You may use your comments on the air. Also, try to be brief and email your comments if you'd like at KETV.com. Click on the Chronicle link. Remember, we love to hear from you, and we'll be right back. And welcome back to this special commitment 2012 edition of KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle. This morning, John Ewing and I have talked about his plan for the economy, for Medicare. We've talked health care, jobs, foreign policy. Now it's your turn to speak directly to the voters about what you want to say to them for your vote. You got a little over about a minute and a half or so.
I'd like to tell the voters that I believe this election is all about leadership. I believe that it's about someone who can go to Washington, D.C., and make a difference. I've been a proven leader in this community for over 30 years, having served you as a member of the Omaha Police Department for almost 25 years, having served you as Douglas County Treasurer for almost 6 years. During that time, I've been able to win national awards working with people and working across party lines to build consensus, because at the end of the day, you don't care about political parties. You care about someone who will address the issues. And that's what I will do. I will make sure that we have a bipartisan jobs bill to put America back to work, because I believe America works best when Americans are working. I will make sure that we have a real solution to Medicare and Social Security so that we can keep those programs strong rather than privatizing them. I will keep my word to you, and I will not vote to privatize Medicare or Social Security. And so I would appreciate your vote on November 6th, because I'm a person who will listen to you and work for you rather than the special interests in Washington, D.C. So thank you.
Thank you. A note to John Ewing, Lee Terry will be going head-to-head in a debate. It'll be held at the Omaha Press Club October 18th. Runs from noon to 1 p.m. Tickets $15. That includes lunch, which begins at 11:30. Remember, Election Day is November 6th. If you haven't voted already, make sure you do. That is our show this morning. Thanks for watching. We'll see you back here next Sunday for another edition of KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle.